Welcome again, and thank you for joining Career Conversations, the Many Paths to Entrepreneurship. Whether you're studying entrepreneurship, working on a business plan for a new venture, or have already started a business, this promises to be an insightful discussion to hear how other entrepreneurs have launched and are navigating successful businesses. I'm Curtis Johnson. I'm a member of the University of Rochester class of 1988. I'm also a member of the University of Rochester Board of Trustees. I co-chair the Diversity Advisory Council, as well as the Black Alumni Network Mentoring and Career Networking Committee. I've spent over 20 years working in the investment management industry and with private equity teams, most recently with the Carlyle Group, one of the largest private equity firms globally. The pandemic and changes across global economies has contributed to an incredible time for entrepreneurs across all business sectors, especially companies focused on disrupting and advancing businesses. I'm thrilled to be here today to introduce the topic and the dynamic moderator we all have the pleasure and good fortune to hear from. First, I'd like to acknowledge the U of R hosts for today's call. Career Conversations is one of the Alumni Relations signature virtual program series, providing the University of Rochester community with professional development, resources, and programming for all stages of life and career. Real Conversations is another signature program. Real Conversations is a lecture and discussion series that offers authentic discussions featuring candid dialogue around equity, measurable action, and meaningful change. And of course, the AIN Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. The AIN Center maintains and expands upon the entrepreneurship opportunities and education for University of Rochester students, faculty, staff, and alumni. They strengthen the entrepreneurship ecosystem through collaborations across the university and by enhancing relationships with the Rochester community and beyond. You'll find links in the main chat to learn more. And if you haven't checked into these programs, I encourage you to visit their sites and find out more about the programs and some of the features that they offer. Today's conversation will cover many aspects of what to consider before you launch your own venture or even join a startup. With entrepreneurship, the possibilities and paths are really, truly unique. The panel of diverse alumni will share how they decided to pursue their entrepreneurial dreams, celebrate their successes, deal with their challenges and failures, as well as their takeaway and strategies they have learned along the way. I encourage you to take notes and ask lots of questions. I'm very excited to introduce the moderator for today's session, my friend Kate Washington. I was first introduced to Kate by another Simon School alum who described Kate as a great person to know, terrific entrepreneur, connector, and business builder with a social conscience. Kate is a managing partner of Enterprise Solutions International, a consulting firm that focuses on small and mid-cap business growth, combining imaginative Main Street economic development strategies with solid financial and operational skills. Not afraid to take on big projects, as former Deputy Commissioner of Neighborhood and Business Development for the City of Rochester, Kate led housing, real estate, business development, and project development activities that helped launch the economic transformation of the City of Rochester. Her continued commitment to the transformation and regeneration of the City of Rochester is one of the driving forces behind her work. Her civic engagement includes leadership in women's economic parity, racial equity issues, the arts, and business development. Kate's unique and non-linear career path is grounded in the education she received while traveling the world as a child in a military family. Kate holds an MBA from the Simon School of Business and a Bachelor of Music from Syracuse University. And Kate also previously served as co-chair of the Simon Alumni Board. It's great to see you again, Kate, and I'm so looking forward to this panel. I'll now turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Curtis. Thank you so much for that beautiful introduction. I really appreciate it. And I'm also thrilled to be here. I'm really thrilled to have you here and also thrilled to be here with this dynamic panel of entrepreneurs that we're going to hear from today. I just have a few things I want to review with you all first. First of all, I'm going to ask everyone to keep your microphones on mute during the panel so that we can avoid any interference from noise during the recording. And I'm also going to ask you to feel free to use the chat box to comment on any of the comments that you hear or any of the questions you may have. But if you do have a question, I'm going to ask if you will put it in a private chat to me directly so that when we get to the end of our panel, I won't miss any of your questions. I want to make sure that we have them all. So the way the format is going to work is that we will hear from all panelists up until about 1 o'clock. Then we'll have plenty of question time for that Q&A that we talked about. And again, I'll remind you to make sure that that I don't miss them. Okay, so welcome to everyone. Now I'm going to just really introduce this fantastic panel. I'm very excited about this dynamic, young and energetic and very talented group. And I met them myself just recently, and I was extremely inspired by all of them. And I'm sure you will too. So I'm going to introduce, and then I'm going to ask them to introduce themselves. And I'm going to start. We've got Brittany Floyd, who's actually the creator and co-founder of Wanderlust Game Company. We've got Anna Games and Yuting Yang, who are co-founders of Sugar House. And we also have Emma Rainwater, who will be representing her company, Rainwater Farms. And she also has a partner, Naomi Salama, who cannot be with us today, but Emma will represent the company. And I'm going to start with all of them. I'm going to start by asking the first question. Instead of reading off their bios to you, I would really like to ask them to just really talk about themselves, tell us a little bit about themselves and their businesses and how they launched their businesses and actually what their initial journey was like when they first started. So I'm going to start with Brittany. So Brittany, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and your business and how you really got yourself to the place where you started to launch your business?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a very long story, so I'm trying to make it brief. But essentially, I grew up in Ann Arbor, Michigan. I feel like when you grow up in a bit of a smaller college town that's kind of insulated, you just want to see the world. And so when I was about 16, I went to Italy with my choir, and that really inspired me to really travel and be in the world. And I thought of every option that I could have to get there. It took me a couple of years until I realized that I could study abroad at my university, and that could be like my next big trip. And so once I did that, I lived in England for a year, and I studied at the University of Derby in England. And from there, I traveled to maybe 9 countries that year in all of Europe and Northern Africa. And yeah, my travel bug was absolutely activated, and I had a new perspective on life. And at the time, I'm 19, and so I'm just open to everything. And so I just started traveling like crazy. And what ended up happening was I loved it so much that I ended up becoming a flight attendant for American Airlines. And from there, I just traveled a whole bunch. I used my social media just to show friends and family. But then what ended up happening was people started asking me about my travels. And so they would ask me like, hey, can you tell me about this? And then so I started a blog, and then the blog was fine. And I updated it, you know, whenever I wanted to. I wasn't a really serious blogger, just wanted to have a resource for people. And then from there, people started saying like, hey, we like your blog, but we want to just come with you. We love the way that you see the world, the way that you approach it. Can we come with you? And so that's how my first group travel company started. And from there, I was doing that, had a number of initiatives that I ran and a different style companies that focus on different things. And then from there, the pandemic happened, and I am about to have the biggest year as an entrepreneur going into 2020. I have partnerships, I have my own trips happening around the world, and I had to stop everything. And so that's when Wanderlust Game Company came into play. It was the summer that I started my MBA, and a few friends and I wanted to figure out how to connect with each other as travelers and how to continue to tell our stories, even though we weren't on the road. And so we came up with Wanderlust Game Company, which is essentially a travel game company for the travel obsessed. I say travel so many times, still working on this pitch. but essentially, the card game was about kind of fostering that communication and those storytelling between like-minded people. And I didn't mean for it to be as big as it is. It was kind of like a passion project. But then when we sold out our first batch, we realized that maybe we did have a company. And so that's kind of where I am right now, where we realized that me and my team, that we have a pretty good product and a pretty good idea. And it's my first product-based business. And so just kind of going through the growing pains of that. But that's how I got here. It's a pretty long story. Hopefully I was able to sum it up pretty fast. But nice to meet you.
Great story, Brittany. You're a woman after my own heart. That was great. Thank you so much. Anna and you team, please talk about your journey.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for having us. So Yuting and I are the owners of Sugar House. We're a macaron company based out in LA. We also have another location in Alaska. And our story is, we'll kind of just go back and forth, but we're both U of R undergrad alums. We went to school for engineering. I graduated 2015 and you team 2016. And we started our macaron business about 2 years ago. And so I guess like the start of the story is more so that, you know, I think we all kind of go to school thinking we're going to be one thing. But I think at the end of the day, it's like, if you're creative, we can all fall into different paths. And I think that's something everyone kind of knows about themselves, or maybe not. Maybe you figure it out along the way. But, you know, Yuting and I have been friends for a really long time. And even within like working in industry after graduating college, it's you know, you can kind of go back and forth between different passions. And so we both worked in our respective fields after graduating. And when the pandemic hit, I actually ended up moving back to Alaska. And then at that point, I wasn't working, and then I was seeing different, just, you know, that gave me time to kind of figure out what I wanted to do next. And it had always, it was kind of like my joke that I was like, oh, when I retire, I will open a coffee shop and have like a nice little community around me. And I just decided, I was like, oh, maybe I'll just unofficially retire from my career, my short career as an engineer, and start this project. And then, you know, I didn't really have any expectations of where it would go, but about a year into starting the business and making macarons in my local community and seeing how that went, Yuting saw what I was up to and wanted to join along. And it was fun. It's great to have a friend that I've known for so long. And we, and even in college, we worked on projects together, and we didn't really expect this to, you know, expect that to lead to anything in the future for us. But now we're business partners and it's been great.
Yeah, I mean, I think Anna summed it up pretty well, but I think just something to add is, it's interesting for us because we started the business in Alaska where Anna's from, and then we're able to be really light on our feet, kind of validate the business that it has commercial value. So then our thinking is, okay, could we do this in the bigger market that we can actually, you know, scale up pretty quickly? So, you know, just through luck and other people's help, we're able to now start this business in LA as well.
Wonderful. Well, obviously we're off to a good start here. Emma, I would really love to hear from you about your business as well. Yours is a very unique business, so I'm very excited about it.
Yeah, absolutely. Emma Rainwater, and my wife and I run our farm together. I'm an alum from 2011 with a bachelor's in history, which is not exactly, you know, relevant to farming. I originally thought that I wanted to be a teacher. And then during my undergraduate degree, I did their Urban Fellows program, which is run by the Community or Center for Community Engagement. And it's a summer internship where you get placed with nonprofit organizations around Rochester, and mine just happened to be with the Westside Farmers Market, which is literally right across the river from campus. And it exposed me to the way that food can really be a huge builder of community. It's something that everybody needs to come together for, and especially in areas in the city where there's not a ton of access to food. Something about it just felt much more right than anything that I had been doing before. So I started to go into nonprofit work. I did a couple of terms with AmeriCorps, working in different areas over the country, and sort of always came back to that idea of food being something that drove me and was important. And after a while, I got kind of burnt out with nonprofit organizations. You know, there's a lot of complexity in that world that wasn't right for what I wanted to do. When my wife and I got married, we sort of had this shared vision of creating a farm as a business. So I started doing that work for a while, and we started our own farm. We now sell vegetables at the farmers market that I interned with in college. We have a mission to be like a really hyper local business, and you know, try and serve the community around us and connect with people as much as possible. So that's kind of where we started and where we're at now.
Well, I'm already hearing a common theme here. Obviously, everybody started off in one field or one interest and evolved, which is, I think, really interesting and very much telling about entrepreneurship. It says that there really are opportunities to really evolve and to really change direction as you go. One of the questions I wanted to ask you, since all of you really had somewhat of a passion about the work that you've done and the business that you launched. So Brittany, you had, you know, you had already launched several businesses. Tell me, how did you fund this?
Yeah, so all my businesses have been self-funded and funded by the sales of the products that I have, products or services. I did have some investor interest for my game company, but my team decided against it just because essentially you have to start thinking about how much equity you're going to give and whether or not you have proven sales. And we were still really early stage. And so it felt a little too early to bring someone in. The only downside of self-funding, both I had group travel operation and now a product-based business, is just that you have to scale really slowly. And that can be pretty tough, especially when you're in a business that, you know, you might have some competition and people kind of moving to market a bit faster than you or anything like that. But I think that for ours, because it's so niche, it's been working for us. And now what the future looks like, I'm not sure. But for the last 6-7 years, I've been self-funded for myself, my partners, and then the revenue that we get from our sales.
Okay. Emma, I'm really interested in how you have funded your business, knowing there's probably a high demand for you financially to launch a farm or an agricultural business.
Yeah, there's a lot of infrastructure up front that's required. Some of it was planning based. So we knew that we were going to have limited access to funds. So we were sort of looking at methodologies that required a little bit less infrastructure up front. So like we didn't buy a tractor right away. We did a lot of stuff by hand and still do. We funded ourselves for the first part and then secured a loan once we knew that we needed a little bit more infrastructure to be able to sell. Which was a little bit of a tricky process, but we were able to get some funding we're approved for a bank loan, and then we're able to have a family member step in and offer the same loan at better rates, which was we were extremely lucky and very grateful to have that opportunity.
Hey, Kate.
That's good. Yes.
I forgot something. So I realized that I just said, oh, I self-funded, but I've always had a job. So I'm one of the entrepreneurs that did not quit my job. I have never quit my job. I just had jobs that had flexibility that allowed me to do stuff on the outside. And I thought that was a really important thing to note, is that the money didn't just come from anywhere. I have a job. I'm not full-time. And so the money was self-funded, but from my actual work.
And great. I'll note, just on top of that, I am now full-time on the farm, but I did hold another job for a while, and we're past it now, but in the first couple of years, we had to supplement with my wife's income as well. So we've definitely gone back and forth a little bit on that.
Yeah, that's good to know.
If I could just jump in, actually, I think this is a really interesting topic. I think a lot of people starting a business have this like assumption that they need a large amount of capital up front. But if you focus on kind of being more agile and starting with something little first, you don't need like 50, 100 grand to like start a business. So for Anna and I, you know, starting a food business, people immediately think about commercial equipment, commercial kitchen, permitting, but we actually started with like cottage food permit, which in some states allowed us to bake out of a home kitchen. So we're able to sell to markets and validate that there is commercial value in our products and slowly ramp up that way. So I would also encourage other, you know, possible entrepreneurs think about how to ramp up. So in the beginning, you don't need a large amount of capital.
Right. Yeah, I think this is important for people to hear, because I think sometimes we all get locked into those stories about people who launch their business and, you know, they find all these investors and they have to really make all these huge sacrifices. I think it makes sense to have an understanding about some of the creativity that's involved in really securing financing and actually growing your business. So that kind of leads me to another question for all of you. And that is, when you think about the scaling of your business, what did you envision and how do you see your business evolving and really managing the scale that you see for your businesses? And I'm going to start with Emma first on that, because obviously you have some really, I think, really interesting information about how you really perceive the growth of your business.
Yeah, my business is actually shrinking a little bit this year intentionally. Because we, when we started, had a lot of vision and a lot of ideas. And we're about 5 years in. And so we've been sort of reevaluating what we want out of the business and why we started it. You know, it's not exactly a project to make money. It's something that's important to us and to our family. We were all set to do some expansion. And then I think, like everybody else, the pandemic really changed kind of what we were looking at. My daughter was born March of 2020. We've done a lot of reassessing of our values and why we're doing this and what's important over the last few years. So we're really focused much more on refining at this point rather than expanding. So we're trying to do the things that we do better. And we're trying to make sure that if we're taking on any new projects, that we're doing it with a lot of intention, and that we're examining the things that we're doing and making sure that they're all still worthwhile and that, you know, they're bringing us some form of joy. Not like, you know, it doesn't have to be the best thing we've ever done, but just making sure that everything has a purpose. And we're not just being busy to be busy.
Instead of trying to follow a path that is predetermined by maybe other businesses or how they believe it should be scaled, talk about how you arrived at your desire to really be intentional about that.
I think some of it has to do with the industry that I'm in specifically. There's, to scale it, it would become something different. You know, it would, like, there's some businesses where you can just sort of get more, you know, more space, more equipment, and you know, up your production. For me to get more space and production, it changes the way that I interact with my main business, which is working the land. You know, so we branch out in terms of value added stuff. So we do like jams and woodworking, and, you know, try and find ways to engage in hobbies that feed our interests and also can add to the value of the company. But, you know, for the most part, it just makes much more sense for us to stay small, to be what we want to be. And it gives us more freedom to be able to look into doing things like educational opportunities, and just to grow in the ways that are valuable for us.
Okay, thank you. And Anna and Yuting, you actually expanded. So can you talk a little bit from your perspective about how you approached the whole concept of scaling?
Sure, yeah. So we're definitely in the expansion stage at this moment, starting from Alaska at a small operation where we don't even have a commercial location, kitchen, to LA with a commercial kitchen in like one of the most expensive spots. So it's definitely a jump up. But definitely what I think our method is, a lot of what Emma was saying is like, we kind of have a vision, right? But at the same time, you have to, it is a lot of trial and error to figure out what works. And I think you need to be agile as an entrepreneur to kind of be able to sniff out the different opportunities. And so I think a lot of the mainstream thought of, oh, having a macaron business is having a brick and mortar store. But during the pandemic, who's going to stores? No one's going to stores. So then that opens up different channels of, you know, sales. So we started doing farmers markets, and turns out everyone was at farmers markets, and outdoor markets are now like the thing now. And so it's all about just, we're learning that it's all about figuring out what works with our personalities, and what, where we can like tap into larger sales channels, and being really in tune with the environment. The way Los Angeles operates is totally different than the way Alaska operates. Alaska, we do so well in farmers markets and the festivals and events in the local community. But LA, we're finding that a lot of people are health conscious in Los Angeles, and people aren't buying as large quantity of macarons. But a thing that is really lucrative in Los Angeles for macarons are big like parties. Like we've done some catering for like, you know, multi-million dollar mansions in Hollywood, which is something like you don't see in Alaska. So it really is just seeing what the, you know, being agile and seeing what the environment is around you and being open to changing things up.
Okay. Brittany, do you want to weigh in on that one?
Yeah, I think that like Emma, my team decided not to scale immediately because we have a team of three women. And when I pitched this idea to them, I told them that I wanted it to be able to grow with us through each stage of our life. And I didn't know what I was saying when I meant that, but I wanted to. So all at once, my team, so I was finishing up my MBA, and I also got recalled to my flight attendant job that I was on furlough from during my MBA program. So I got really, really busy. Another one of my co-founders had a baby. The other co-founder, her grandmother passed away in Guatemala, and she went back to manage the estate and get it all prepped and sold. And so at once, all of us kind of were going through big life moments. And so like I said, we had people who are interested in investing, and we had support through an accelerator. And so we had a lot of things going, but we couldn't go because personally, all of us were going through things. And so my team decided to take a pause to reevaluate once I graduated and once, you know, the baby was born and everything was happening. And we all decided collectively that, yes, this is important. We do love this product and where we think it could go, but the timing for us was not right. And now that I'm working again and I have capital, and now that we have, you know, some months that my friend has, you know, my coworker has, our co-founder has been a mother, and my other co-founder is back from Guatemala and in a good space. Now we're going to set processes and set our sights a little higher, because we've had a lot of interest in terms of wholesaling, and we have our sights on being acquired someday, or at least having it to the point where we don't have to do any of the shipping or any of the fulfillment, but we have a third party doing it. So yeah, ours was very intentional, just like Emma. It was just that it wasn't that we don't have the space or, you know, all the things. It was just that personally, my whole team at once really needed a second to reset our lives, because we're humans. And so now we're feeling really confident that we can move forward and that we can do it, but it just took a second. And so yes, we scaled very slowly. We're still very much at that kind of ramp up point, but we feel good about it, and we're happy that we didn't try to rush it through while we were all going through so much.
Well, that is really helpful to know. I mean, in making sure that you always take in consideration the human factor of what you're doing, and also having the ability to be agile as well. Sounds like these are really important skills to develop. I'm going to sort of shift the conversation a little bit now, because I want to talk a little bit about what I consider to be an essential part of being an entrepreneur. Most people tend to avoid it, but I really believe that we have to, in some ways, really begin to normalize failure. So I want to talk about what was your biggest mistake or your biggest failure in your business. And of course, then what did you learn from it? Because that's the most important part of failure. That's why we have it. So let's start with both you, Ting, and Anna. If you can talk about what your biggest failure was, and we'd love to hear it.
I mean, I guess I can start. I think some of the bigger, I mean, it's the same. I saw Curtis' question in the chat as well, and I kind of feel like the two tie in together is when your company is growing, you kind of have the perception is, okay, first, second month, double the sales of the first month, the third month, double the sales of the second month. that's just the trajectory it's going to go. So then the expenses started racking up, and then, you know, we just had that expectation. And then obviously with Los Angeles being so hot in the summer, and we weren't in business for a full year, we didn't understand the seasonality of our business. We had to kind of like shrink everything a little bit, manage the expenses, like making sure we get to the fall, having enough cash flow. So I think it just understanding there's going to be highs and lows in the business. And, you know, when you're at the high point, don't get too excited, making sure you're being stoic and keep working. And then when you're getting a low point, understand that you need to seek out different opportunities. So I think that's like the biggest lessons learned, or I guess like in a way, some failures as well.
Okay. Brittany?
Yeah, I think that at least for me, there's been a lot. I mean, I've learned from failures. I just fail forward. But I think that the one for my current business is just that we are a e-commerce product-based business, and my team was not ready for the holiday season last year in terms of being poised to really have enough inventory and just be ready for one of the biggest moments in, honestly, retail. And the thing is that I have had service-based businesses my whole time as an entrepreneur, and this was the first product-based one. And so we just kind of mismanaged some of those, the key things that we needed to get everything sorted and all the relationships we needed to build, and just ramping up some of our social media promotions and other types of grassroots promotions. And so I think that for us coming into this next holiday season, we're a little bit more prepared and we're ready for what's next. But I think that last year we were not prepared for one of the biggest periods of the year for retail, and so we missed out on a lot, I think, and so moving forward we want to make sure to not miss out again, but like I said, it was all due to circumstance, but now we've learned a lot from that, so we're really poised for the future, so that's good. But yeah, not like when you have, like, again, that seasonality thing is so important. Knowing when your business is going to be the hottest and knowing when you have to be ready is half the battle. So
it's good. Emma.
Yeah, I've made a lot of mistakes. So I don't think this is specific to my industry, but there are like so many possibilities of what you can do with a piece of land. And I think that Naomi and I both struggle with getting too excited about the idea of a project or an enterprise, or like, oh, that won't be too hard. We can, you know, we can just buy some piece of equipment and then we can also do this. So I think that out of all the various little mistakes we've always made, I think that the biggest failure that we've had is, overestimating what we can do with our time. That's been a huge lesson, and I'm still learning it every year, because it's, you know, our time is finite and we want to do other things. And unfortunately that means that, like, we've had a few projects where we sort of started working on it, and then, you know, like you're saying about seasonality, right? Like, if I start a project in the spring, I have a ton of time because that's before there are vegetables growing and things to harvest. I'm like, oh yeah, that'll be easy. I've got tons of time. And then once summer comes and it's crunch time and like we're working crazy hours every day, like the project that I got very excited about and invested some money into gets kind of forgotten about or thrown to the side. I don't think it's the kind of failure where like I could have done anything else about it. Like, I think that it sort of had to happen that way for me to learn. Otherwise I just wouldn't have been able to take that lesson away from it. But there've definitely been a few times where, you know, we've for sure made the wrong choice about ramping up a part of the business, which, you know, not to be overly repeating myself, but like, that's why we're trying to do more of the refining, because we know that we get too excited and then it ends up really biting us in the end.
Right. Well, I think that, you know, some of the experiences that you've shared are, I think, very common, and in some cases they're unique, But one of the things I wanted to ask all of you is that clearly there are challenges that maybe all of you have experienced in some way that really come from being systemically excluded business owners. And that includes BIPOC business owners, LGBTQ owners. We recognize that these are some of the hurdles that you have to overcome as well. And what issues or topics have you faced that you think you would like to share that you think can be of value to people who might have be experiencing some of these same challenges? And maybe how did you overcome them, or how are you overcoming them? Whoever wants to go first can start on that.
I was thinking about it as you were asking the question, just because mm-hmm. I know that Black women have the least amount of funding out of all of the startups in the world. And so I think that I went into this process just knowing that I probably wasn't going to get funding. And I think that I'm not sure if that's me putting a glass ceiling on myself. You know, I think when I started, I'm not sure. I think a lot of it's internalized. And so it's hard to say how that really played out for me. But I think that I didn't even have a consideration that that was possible, especially with my product-based business. And the business before that, it was hard because it was just group travel is high risk. And so nobody wants to invest. Doesn't matter what you look like or who you are or what your background is. It's just a really risky business. But I think this next one, I think that I went into it just assuming that we would have to bootstrap it and we'd have to raise our own money. And so when we got investor interest so early, I was actually a little bit thrown aback. And but it was also from a Latinx man. So it was like someone who knows, you know, that that my group is historically excluded from, you know, this kind of financing. And so I think that it was just a really unique situation, but I was so thrown aback. I had no clue that that was actually going to happen, especially so early. But I think that I personally, when I think about what my options are, I think that if I'm being honest, I limit myself. I don't think that it's impossible, but I just know that when I'm ready to do that, that I have to be like perfect. I have to have everything in order. My sales need to be perfect. My team needs to be perfect. My advisory board needs to be perfect. Everything needs to be perfect. And I was on the VC fund at Simon, which was really exciting. And we got to interact a lot and interact in that community. And it just seems to me that like other folks who are not underrepresented or historically excluded, or the words that we use now, it seems as if they can kind of get by without as much perfection. And so, yeah, it's a larger conversation, and it's really dynamic, and it's hard to say. So yeah, I tried.
Well, in response to that, do you have the opportunity to talk with others who may be experiencing some of those same challenges?
Yeah, I have been able to build community around like Black women entrepreneurs. But what I found is that we are all in similar places, you know, at similar scales, with similar resources. And so there's not really a lot of people who have kind of broken that kind of mold, that are out there being like mentors and, you know, kind of showing the way. Not saying it's not impossible, it's just that most of the people that I have engaged with right now are all very much in the smaller scale. And that's pretty typical for Black women businesses to be on the smaller mm-hmm. scale. And I know that I could probably do a bit more work in terms of looking and seeking and trying to figure out, you know, how, what other communities I can build with, maybe not just build mm-hmm. with Black women, but, you know, open my network a little bit wider to everyone, anyone who's willing to help. So it's just been a bit of a journey, but yeah, I definitely have started to build that community, but I realize that it's limiting in itself because we're all in very similar places. Mm-hmm.
Well, you just put the word out there. Emma, do you have, can you share any challenges you may have experienced?
To some extent, or, you know, in different ways. Probably the most straightforward is that I'm in a very male-dominated field, which has, it has some connotations in terms of people taking you seriously, and, you know, sort of acknowledging that you do know what you're doing. And also the kind of work that I'm doing specifically relies on a lot of skill sets that weren't necessarily accessible to me as a young person. Mm-hmm. So like I've had to learn a lot about like how to fix machines, and you know, how to use a chainsaw safely, and stuff like that. So, you know, there's sort of the direct things like that. In terms of like being part of the LGBTQ community, it has an impact in sort of indirect ways for us. You know, one of the reasons that we came back to Rochester, we had sort of moved around for a few years, and we weren't sure where we wanted to settle to start a family, which was really important to us. And one of the considerations was finding a community in a place that we knew would be safe for us and for our kids. And it's still like a consideration sometimes about like how much I want to put our family out there on social media and things like that. You know, like I don't necessarily want to open my daughter up to whatever may come with having two moms. But at the same time, like I like having speaking out and like talking about our family because I love my family. And I think what we're doing is really cool. But you know, it's in some ways kind of scary and in some ways kind of limiting. And it makes us really question. We have to think really carefully about like what we say and how much of ourselves we give. And I don't think that that's necessarily any different from anyone when you're in a position where, you know, you want to put yourself as a public face of a business, but there are some extra considerations that we need to take into account. And I think that's probably the most direct way that we've been impacted by any kind of systemic exclusion or concerns in general.
And I'll ask you the same question I asked Brittany. Have you been able to build any sense of community with other, maybe not business?
Sorry, Kate, I lost the last half of the question again.
Do you have other supports out there?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think that I have thankfully had a lot of support through the AIM Center and through you know, resources that I've had through Next Corp. And I actually would hope to continue, even though I'm an alum, to be able to use those services. And I feel like I have networks from the different communities I lived. Like I lived in Philadelphia and there's a big entrepreneurship community that I have there, as well as in Detroit, there's a big kind of movement of entrepreneurship there too. So I've been connecting across, you know, my different networks, but I feel like there's always more that you can do. But for me, that's the networks that I have kind of tapped into.
So we've been lucky that our competitors in this region are also some of our best friends. You know, in that respect, like I feel like there are some areas where we would potentially be excluded, but here in Rochester, there's like a beautiful community of mostly people who are doing sustainable or organic farming who are just like the most welcome, wonderful people. And even though they're technically competitors, like none of us really see it that way. You know, like everyone will drop what they're doing for a day and go help someone else if they had a fire or if they need extra hands planting garlic or whatever it may be. And we've always been able to like lean on that support. And we're also really fortunate to have wonderful family. And, you know, I think we all are familiar with the Rochester area. And I think one of my favorite things about it has always been that however many problems the city and the surrounding communities have, there's always so much openness and caring about our neighbors and community. And I have seen nothing but that reflected since we've been back and started our business.
That's good to hear. Anna and Yuqing.
I think Anna also has some stories. I think for us, since we are younger alums. Age has definitely been a challenge for us, especially operating a business with so many different, not just like having to deal with customers and consumers, but with our suppliers and partners. And, you know, I've had people, when we're negotiating a lease, we've had people tell us, you know, what do you guys know about the lease terms? Like, you have to do this much deposit or this, which, you know, we're just trying to get the best deals for us. So I think in those situations, I would just recommend anybody in the same shoes as us to be a little bit narcissistic and believe in themselves and believe that they know better what their business needs and continue to, to like stick out for themselves.
Yeah, the biggest challenge that comes to mind for us is like our age. Like, people definitely think of us, a lot of people that we talk to when we are looking for advice about like loans and just how about our business, it feels like we get instantly kind of like bucketed into their minds as like, oh, they're talking to us like we're their daughters. And so when that happens, a lot of these people turn into like parent mode and start giving us very risk averse advice or just kind of, you know, like kind of like tampering our expectations on things. I was on the phone with a banker, a loan officer at a local bank in Alaska. And I was just asking him questions like, so how do I go about getting a loan? If I were to like want $1 million for our business, like how does that happen? And he was asking questions about our business, of course. And I was giving him information. This was pretty early on, but I'm still just learning. And he basically scoffed and was like, oh, so this is just still a side project for you. And I'm just like, I probably work more hours in a week than you do, buddy. Like, you know, and so there's certain situations like that where at the end of the day, though, you kind of have to have tough skin, you know, and then you just got to toss those people aside. And then there's always people who are excited that we're young and excited that we have so much potential. And we're so excited. Like, we have energy, you know, even if we're young, we have more energy. Like, that's, use that towards our advantage. And so you got to look at the bright side. When you can.
Great. Well, this is a question. It also was in the chat coming from Curtis. It was a question I was going to ask anyway. Knowing what you know now, is there anything you'd have done differently in launching your business? Emma, you want to go first?
Yeah. Sure, mine's quick. I would have hired employees sooner. That's a big one for me. That's it.
Okay.
Yeah, for me, I think it would be to believe in myself a little earlier. My business, I was operating it as like my first one, at least as a group travel operator. I was giving those services for free. And I know that's what people do sometimes, like, you know, give people samples of their product, but I wasn't even thinking about it as a business. I was just like, yeah, come along. Great. And then I was actually planning every little detail and doing all these things, talking to vendors, finding, you know, the perfect tour, the perfect spot to stay, putting in a lot of hours and hours of effort. And so I would have taken myself as seriously a little earlier. I think that I would have had some, you know, been able to kind of accelerate a bit faster if I had taken it seriously and just didn't think it was some kind of like hobby that I just did for fun when I wasn't flying. And then for my other business, I think it would be that just like Emma, I think we would have contracted earlier. My team of three, we tried to, you know, do everything. And I realized that that's like the expectation of entrepreneurs is to wear many hats, but there's some hats that you're just not that good at or that take a lot more effort and that, you know, you should look at not only like what can you do by yourself, but what kind of time does it take and what's the quality of the work? And, you know, is this something that will really impact my brand and the way that it is perceived or, you know, drive someone's brand preference or whatever it may be. And so I think that there are some things that we would have just contracted out instead of trying to do it in-house.
Okay. Anna?
Yeah, I think, employees is a good topic. Yuting and I actually hired employees pretty early on. But I think one of the things for me is letting my employees kind of have more freedom in the sense I was I operate more as like a micromanager where I have specific expectations for how things are done, which can be definitely straining for certain people. And I think I have a lot of issues with trusting people to see what they can do if I, you know, kind of let the leash loose. Yuting's very good at that though, and letting people harness their own strengths. And maybe it wasn't in the particular way that we initially like had them on for. They can have their own strength and we can recreate like a team around that as well. And so I think just like the difference in team management, you know, as entrepreneurs, we focus a lot on the business side, but the team side is so important, harnessing a culture where everyone works really well together and just knowing each other's strengths and focusing on that, I think is really important. And we have that locked down pretty well now. So I'm really happy about that.
Yeah, I think it's definitely right what Anna said and what everybody else said. And I think for me, just as somebody who went from very traditional corporate to starting a business, I was always daunted by all the logistical aspect of starting a business, like incorporation, tax returns, and this and that. But now that I've operated a business for a little bit, those things can be very easily like outsourced and done. So if you're somebody thinking about starting a business, don't feel like daunted just by how much of those kind of ops level tasks you need to do. You can easily find a service or somebody to help you with that, and you can focus on the parts that are important, which is like generating sales and growing your business.
Great. This is all very good advice. I hope everybody's paying attention, because these are things that you will hopefully sidestep. Oh, interested in doing so. I just have one more question for everybody, and that is, if you could just tell me, how do you define success for your business?
Okay, I'm gonna go first because I feel like my answers is not as appetizing. I have a very boomer level answer. I think for us, Anna and I are always looking at our revenue and the income. And, you know, we want to get to a level where we are pretty comfortable financially and then our employees are being paid well. So I think that's our very commercial sense of success. But on the more like human side, you know, we want to build a company that's very well liked by everyone. We're spreading joy through macarons, and then we're going out to different neighborhoods, different events. And, you know, we constantly get calls from people being like, oh my God, I love your product. Like, where can I get them next? So we want to get to a point that we scale more in that sense as well.
Okay.
Yeah, I can speak to that. I mean, obviously revenue is important. For us, our business model is a little strange because the way that agriculture works is you don't really want to make too much money. It's odd as an entrepreneurial venture, but it has to do with sort of funny tax structures. So it helps to offset the income taxes from my wife's full-time job. So complicated situation. But so as long as the farm can support itself, that counts to me as a success, as long as we're in the black, as long as we're not borrowing money from, you know, from our savings and our retirement, as long as we're able to put money away for retirement, which so far we have been able to every year. You know, as part of that, I want us to be able to do all of those things and also support employees with a good wage. It's my dream to be able to offer like healthcare, and other benefits that's not standard in my industry. Typically, you know, you get your hourly wage from March through November, and then the rest of the year you're sort of left to fend for yourself. I'd really like to figure out ways for my business to retain year-round employees so that we can maintain people year after year, because a lot of us work alone. That's just the way that this has worked over the last like 20 or so years that like small organic agriculture has been sort of a popular idea for people. And there is just inherently a lot of instability in the industry. So for me, I think, you know, my image of success is when we're able to offer something that has more of that stability that you'd see from a more traditional company, where, you know, we have one or two or three people who are here year round, they have things to do, maybe we could pay a salary. You know, it's the kind of thing where we're still trying to figure out the details of it. But we want to try and see if we can figure out how to make that work in the context of our like very tiny family oriented business, to have something that is, you know, a really positive experience for employees and for us. And that's pretty critical to our success, I think.
Thanks, Brittany. Yeah.
And I think for me, there's a number of things I feel like that we define as success. The first is just being able to carve out this niche. There's a lot of categories in gaming, and a lot of them are leisure, lifestyle type of categories. And we feel that travel can be one of those. And to be at the forefront of that is really exciting for us, to be able to gamify travel in a way that makes people think a little deeper about travel and the world and themselves and how they show up. And then the other part is really just being able to have passive income, because I think that my team from the beginning decided that none of us wants to quit our jobs. And so to be able to scale it in a way that we can have other people operating it for us, or having, you know, like I said, like a third party distributor doing our shipping and, you know, all that stuff, and not having to really think about it, that would be great. And then we also have a goal of just being in some of our favorite retailers. We'd love to be in Target. We'd love to be in all of our favorite small little shops and gift shops around the world. And not just this product, but a whole suite of products. We have about like 12 concepts that we've come up with for different types of games, like strategy and party games and all kinds of fun things, VR, AR experiences, stuff in the digital space. And so to be able to actually create those products and to have them in our favorite shops would be our dream. So.
Great. Thank you so much. Well, it is 1 o'clock. And I think this is a great point to open up the questions. We are getting some questions from everybody here. And I'm going to start with the question that just came in the chat. And that was, the question was, did you ever pivot from your original idea? And what business insights came from those pivots?
I can start. So for Wanderlust Table, our initial idea was that we would, like, we just, the Wanderlust deck was just like a MVP to show that people wanted to like gather around travel or talk about travel or connect through travel. And we thought that we would kind of create more of like a home decor business. So like, or like essentially importing different goods from around the world, things like that. And then as we started working with our kind of mentors and advisors, and as we started telling people about the idea, they were really confused. One, they're like, wait, what kind of business is this? We're like, lifestyle. They're like, no, what is this business? We're like, you know, we'll see. But then once we actually like made the product and people started testing it and using it, they were like, I think this might be the business. And we're like, really? Really? And they're like, yeah. And then I actually took some time to actually learn how to build games and kind of immerse myself in that world and just seeing like the opportunity that was out there in the game world. And not just in the video game space, there's a lot of growth happening in the board and table game space. And so I realized that, wow, there's an opportunity here to do something really unique, to carve out this niche. And it's through games, and it doesn't have to be, you know, just overall, I think millennials love this like lifestyle thing, because we want to have freedom to make it whatever we wanted to make it. But I think that people really enjoy knowing what it is that you can provide for them. And if you want to surprise them sometimes, or maybe offer some, you know, some extensions, like that's fine. But I think when you first come out, having a very solid understanding of who you are as a company and what you want to provide is really important. And so I think that once we kind of, you know, regathered ourselves and realized that we did not have to be all these things, and that we could be a game company, and that was just fine. It helped us really refine our idea and kind of move forward, and it's been really exciting ever since.
Great, thank you. Anybody else want to respond to that?
I can talk on behalf of Sugar House. So we have our macaron business in Alaska, and Alaska does really well in farmers markets. And so when we brought the same business to LA, we just thought like, hey, why can't we use the same model? We should expect about a similar like percentage of like sales from, you know, farmers markets versus like custom orders. And we couldn't have been any more wrong. And so now we're pivoting our just sales channels and our efforts towards more so catering and custom catering orders, and still definitely employing like using farmers markets for steady revenue. I think it took us about the difference in our sales channels and just revenue compared to Alaska, we recognized pretty early on. I think it took us like a month to be like, okay, so this isn't working, or this isn't going to work the same way. And then we probably continued for about 4 to 5 months with the same model still, because even if you recognize the problem, it's not like a, you know, snap of a finger to switch models. You have to like learn the, how are we going to switch over? And so now we're more pivoting towards custom catering and how can we market towards that as well. So in general, it's taken us about, 5 to 6 months to make that pivot and to learn how to do it well. But it's been fun.
Great.
I can speak to this as well, actually. We're in the process of doing this, which is why I didn't think of it right away, because it's like literally right now we're kind of doing that. We started our business as like sort of a sustainable CSA, so community supported agriculture. The idea is, you know, you get a box of food every week, you sign up for a subscription in the beginning of the year, and farmers markets for us were kind of a supplement to that. But I don't know if this is a side effect of the pandemic, but I've actually seen our customer base change quite a bit. Over the last like year and a half or so, where I think that people have different expectations for what a CSA or a farm share is than what they used to. So like the original idea of it was very much like, you know, support local agriculture, you know, we kind of share in the successes and failures of a farm, which is a great idea and has been around for more than 20 years now, probably. And a lot of people use that model. But I've been getting a lot more complaints about things I wouldn't have gotten complaints about before. Like people are really concerned with getting their money's worth now. Whereas before, I think it was less of a, it just wasn't something that people thought about with that model. So anyway, it's been making us sort of rethink where we're at. We just got into a bigger farmers market in the last 2 years. So we're actually planning to completely drop that subscription-based model because it's something that has made our business more challenging than we'd like it to be. So we're sort of in the process of exploring alternatives because we still need like literally seed money in the beginning of the year. So we're still going to try and figure out if we can sell like, you know, some kind of gift card program or something like that. But not doing like the weekly subscription boxes, which had made up about a third of our revenue over the last few years. But kind of the hassle that's been coming along with it lately, or just the time that we've been spending managing customers compared to kind of what would work a little easier with our model. So we're like in the process of figuring out kind of what that's going to look like right now, and how to move forward without alienating a lot of our customer base who's sort of traditionally supported us that way. So we're trying to figure out how to keep those people but move to something else. And it's an interesting process. There's a lot of things to consider. And we can't do anything quickly. We you know, people sign up for the whole season. So the season's not over until mid-October. And that's kind of when we can start pushing out what next year looks like. So yeah, pivoting is important. And finding out like what works both for revenue and for you, because I found out that I don't love like managing customer complaints. Like I would rather be doing the logistical work and like getting food to people. I don't want to hear about how like, you know, oh, that one eggplant was a little bit too small for you. Like, I'm sorry, like, but I'm not a customer service person. So my wife does that. But yeah, anyway, so we're learning.
Very interesting. I want to just remind everybody that we also have Curtis Johnson here, who's extremely well-versed in probably a lot of the topics you might even be considering. He's willing to answer any questions you may have as well. So I'm just throwing that out there. I do want to ask a question that came in. And this is, I think this is a pretty interesting question. It says, how do you stay motivated when you hear no?
I'd like to say a quote that I saw on LinkedIn, which is, why does it matter that not everybody likes you? You don't even like everybody. True for marketing and business. So I think Anna and I get told all the time that our macarons are very expensive. They are, because they're macarons. They're not like the cost of a chocolate chip cookie. Because the raw ingredient is more expensive, the labor is more expensive. So when we hear, you know, somebody tell us this is too expensive, or like, oh my God, you know, macarons, but not for me. That's not our target consumer anyways. We kind of, through trial and error, understand what our target demographics is. And we try to pivot into the areas where we can connect with those customers better. So I think that's like a lesson learned for me, at least.
Thanks.
I'll add to Yu Ting's comment. A no is a great feedback from a customer. When a customer gives you a no, that means they've thought about the question, they've thought about your business, and they've decided that for one reason or another, that it's not for them at the moment. And so you had, they provide you with a great opportunity to do exactly as Yu Ting mentioned, to figure out what is it that is the objection? How can you make your product or service better? And how can you turn them into a yes? And so, you know, yes is obviously the desired answer to many of our questions all the time, but getting no is a great opportunity to just kind of dig in and say, okay, what can I do better? And how can you think about that to improve your business?
Yep, that's my same question. My same answer is that, like, when I get a no, then I start wondering, well, why did I get a no? I feel like they would be my target customer, and why do they not want to buy my game? You know, like they're like this, like, you know, very social forward, you know, travelers that have lots of friends who are really engaging. And so why wouldn't they want it? And I think that one of the things that we found was that our product is experiential. And all of our promotions are static. They're just like this, they just show what the cards are, what they say on them. And so we realized that in our next iteration of our kind of marketing campaign for the fall is just that we have to actually show people what it is that our product does. We can't just say to people, we have a game company for travelers and that we're creating these conversations. They want to see how it's actually playing out. We need video. We need, you know, stuff online to have resources to kind of show them how to play. I think that when you build a product, sometimes you feel like it's just like, oh, this is so easy. They just get it. It's a game. You just put it down on the table. You just have a conversation. So easy. But we have instructions inside. That's not, yeah. Once they got to that point where they actually bought it, it's probably because they engaged with someone on my team or they've played with us or something. And so I think that for us, we just realized that you have to really understand the kind of product that you have. And for us, like I said, it's experiential. And so when we got those no's, we were just like very confused, but it helped us really learn about who our consumers were, what they want, and how to market to them, really.
I think that's really insightful too, about like the idea of really connecting with people. Because I get that the same thing that Yuting was talking about, where people will be like, oh, that's too expensive. Why is that so expensive? But I do find that like half the time, if you can engage someone in a conversation about why it's expensive, or if you can, it's not even necessarily a conversation. If you have a story to tell about the product, you know, if you can tell a story about the product and about you and have like a really honest engagement with someone, a lot of the time, even if people choose not to buy it still, for me, at least, sometimes they'll buy something else, or sometimes, you know, they'll like go and they'll talk about it with their friends, or they'll, you know, they'll like send someone over because they noticed that we had something that they might not have noticed if they had just, you know, walked away after that interaction. So, that like connection with people and getting them to understand what you're selling and why, and you know, what makes it special, can have a really big impact on a no. You know, it's an opportunity to, it's like Curtis says, it's an opportunity to learn, and to figure out what we can do better, or how we can help to educate the people that we're talking to about what we're doing.
I'd like to mention one thing too about how I keep my motivation. In the past, I've worked by myself, but in my current venture, I made sure to be very intentional about building a team that I really wanted to work with, that had different skill sets. And I think that for all of us, we help keep each other motivated. So when we have moments where we're like, oh, should we keep doing this? We've got so much going on. We have all these things. And like, no, like we've seen the impact of our game. We've seen the ways that people connect and the things that they share with us. And so it's really cool to have, you know, not just yourself, but a team to keep yourselves accountable and motivated. And it's so much better than when I was working by myself.
Definitely, if I can pitch in on what motivates me, like when things, you know, because being an entrepreneur is definitely, you have a lot on your plate. But I think if you're an entrepreneur, you kind of, it's really hard to like force us into a cubicle working 9 to 5. And if you've done that, then that you can use that as motivation to be like, I can't do that. I already tried it. I don't want to. So this is the only path, you know? And I think that's what keeps us going.
Okay. I have another question here, and this one, I'm just going to read the question. It says, Mark Cuban from Shark Tank once quoted with a comment regarding the importance of hustle and agility when building an entrepreneurship or startup business. While each of you previously discussed times in your lives in which you had to balance a full-time job with your startup ideas, would you be able to comment on the concept of hustle, especially during that time of transition, and struggles to stay on the path you were previously on while considering the change and transition to your entrepreneurial idea and eventually streamlining that entrepreneurial idea?
Okay, I guess I'll start. I think as an entrepreneur, I'm sure all of us on the panel we're just natural figure outers. I like to call it. They're just problems all the time and you have to figure them out. I think the biggest motivation, at least for Anna and I, is we had made some people consider risky bets, where we had had a commercial kitchen, bought commercial equipment, and had, you know, people help us with funding, etc. That kind of forced us to hustle to make sure we can pay back our credit cards and people who helped us. So I think just adding that stress and goalpost on ourselves and kind of be like, oh, if we grow organically, we will probably get this much money next year. And then the next year after that, it's this much revenue versus, okay, now we have to pay back this much money. So now let's just go get it work. So that's kind of how we've done it. It's a very brute force way of doing it, for sure. I don't recommend it for everybody, but if you feel like you have the appetite for risk and you are thinking about entrepreneurship and you have some safety net that you can fall back on, I would make sure to put some goalposts and stress to yourself to make sure you can really get to that point.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think that for me, in terms of my relationship to, or the importance of hustle and agility, I think agility is a non-negotiable. You have to be agile as when you're a business owner, a small business scaling, wherever you have to be agile. But I think that my relationship to hustle has changed. I think that the first like 4 or 5 years of me being an entrepreneur, it was hustle, hustle, hustle. But I don't think that I was necessarily taking care of myself so much and not acknowledging my own limitations and needs and what I need to do to show up as my full self and be as productive as possible and to really execute what I need to do. So I think that my relationship with hustle is different. I have to have a bit more control over it. I try to hustle smarter, not harder. And I value my rest and I don't want to be up working 6-7 days a week anymore. I don't think that that's necessary for me. I think that as much as I am entrepreneurial and I don't think that I can even try to get the bone out of my body, I also am a human that has needs, that needs rest, that needs to have my mental health in check. And so in terms of hustle, it's necessary, but you have to really control it. And so the way that I kind of structure it is I give myself structure times to do the hustle. So if I know that, you know, on the weekends, maybe like I have a block of 4 hours on Sundays that I contribute to the times that I do the most hustle. And there, I do have maintenance throughout the week and things that I need to take care of. I need to go do shipments and things. But for me, I don't want to run myself to the ground. I don't want to burn out because it really impacts you in the way that you kind of navigate your relationships and the people around you and your clients and your, you know, your vendors, whoever. Like if you are crashing and you are not, you know, and you're not sleeping and, you know, it does not serve you well. And I do agree that there are points in time where you kind of got to buckle down and just like push out a 12-hour day and, you know, really just, you know, focus. But I think that we should definitely be talking about, you know, how do entrepreneurs balance their life and have a life while being entrepreneurs? I mean, I'm not a millionaire, so maybe I'm not the best person to say this, but I just believe that there has to be some kind of balance, being able to have some sort of a life, as well as having your mental health in check and your physical health as well. So I think that you got to hustle smarter instead of harder.
All right.
So I think Mark Cuban said that, and I think Draymond agreed with him. I think Draymond wrote a book on it. How to hustle, rise and grind. And, you know, to Brittany's point, when you're an entrepreneur, when you're working, super difficult, right? Because you're trying to do your job, your day job, while you're trying to get a business off the ground, connect with whoever you need to connect with, whether it be suppliers, customers, whomever, get your business off the ground. That is a lot of hustle and a lot of agility. So I see it in the private equity world. I see it from the standpoint of entrepreneurial sometimes, and I see it from portfolio companies that you know we have an investment in, that you know folks are constantly trying to position or introduce their businesses, and so in every situation it's always an opportunity to meet a potential client, to talk about their business, to talk about how it could be beneficial to wherever the situation is. You'd be surprised, right? You'd think that at some point someone gets to a certain level where they stop hustling. And the people that have these large businesses never stop hustling. They're constantly talking about their businesses, constantly wherever they are, you know, introducing their brand and going out and doing something. And so the idea of being hustling and having agility, I think it's something that, you know, quite frankly, that I think is, you know, you try to balance it, but I think it comes with the territory. And so as you kind of grow with your business, I mean, you know, in many cases, like the owner, the business owner becomes, you know, it's their baby. So wherever they are, they're with their baby and they're talking about their baby and they're wanting to grow their baby into a, you know, into a bigger entity. So I think it's part of it. You know, it's a balancing act for sure. But I think that probably not, depending on your growth expectations and what you're trying to do, probably a big part of business planning, right? And how you actually get the message out. There's no good, you know, you want more people to be aware of your business, more people to be aware of what your activities are. And that happens through hustle.
Okay. I have another question. This one is for Sugar House, and that is, how do you address the challenges with the sugar-free products and the connotations associated with sugar? I love everything sugar, but many don't. So,
yeah, I mean, it really is a thing that we get a lot where people are like, oh, do you have keto options? Do you have any sugar-free options? And we use these questions to help with product development for future iterations. And, you know, it is unfortunate. We can't please everyone. And, you know, like Yuting was saying, like they might not be our target demographic, but we don't want to, but because of that, but with that being said, we don't want to let like leave customers feeling like they have a like bad taste in their mouth, be like, sorry, we can't help you. It's more so just asking them questions like, oh, okay, well, we haven't thought about it. Like, what do you have any like suggestions for sugar-free, like sweeteners? Like, what do you do with like your sugar-free diet? And we just use that as like a way to engage with our customers, really. And even if we can't help them at that moment in time, they at least know that we're listening to them. We gain something out of it. And then eventually maybe our paths will cross again where we can offer them sugar, you know, sugar-free macarons.
Yeah. And I think all it ends up is really a business decision as well. There are definitely alternatives out there right now. We're trying to do research. It's just more about keeping the cost down. That's at the same level of our normal ingredients that we buy in bulk. So maybe in the future that we can have it in our lineup.
Okay. And I have one final question, and that is around the topic that Curtis just mentioned just in his last comment, and that was around entrepreneurship. And this one says, entrepreneurship is a term used in large corporations for employees that exhibit entrepreneurial spirit in their work. They take initiative, look at the areas of responsibility as if they were running their own business in certain areas of brand, product, category management, and it's an important skill and positive mindset to have. How can you develop these skills and support this mindset for employees? Entrepreneur, being an entrepreneur, but having an entrepreneurial mindset.
One thing that we've done with employees that we've hired recently is basically offered to provide like support and limited funding for them to do some kind of project of their own, something that they can genuinely have ownership over. That, you know, they can use us and our resources, but it is their thing. Like I have an employee right now who's interested maybe next year in starting her own hot sauce company. So if she does end up doing that, then like we'll probably grow the peppers here and help with access to a commercial kitchen and things like that. So I think, that's a project that benefits both of us, really. So I think that one of the ways you can encourage that is genuinely being supportive of what people's independent entrepreneurship ideas are. And what I found with people, at least, is that kind of in concert with that, it gives them more of a sense of ownership about everything that's happening with your business, because there's a part of it that genuinely can belong to them, at least eventually.
I think Emma answered it from a point of us as owners, how can we encourage that? I think on the flip side, if you are someone who is in a large corporation and you're trying to develop entrepreneurial mindset, I think the easiest thing to do is probably just really figure out what you want and then kind of figure out all the ways that you can try to get that. Like let it be a promotion or getting on a specific project that you like. So that involves like networking with people, developing really good relationship with executives, and understand that you need to have you know, executive support in a lot of things you want to do, and just and then think about it as like the long game you're trying to play at a company. So yeah, I think it's really just about keeping your eyes out and always open yourself up for different opportunities and connections.
Great. I'm going to wrap this up at this point, as much as I hate to, because this has been a really fantastic conversation with everybody. I want to thank all of the panelists. I want to thank all of you for being here. I want to turn this over to Annette Durnack from the AIMS Center, who has some words for you. So I'm going to turn this over to Annette right now. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. And thank you so much for leading today's discussion. And of course, to our incredible panelists, Emma, Brittany, Anna, and Yuting, you all did a fabulous job. We appreciate you sharing your inspiring stories with us, the challenges that you are all working through, and hopefully the many takeaways and learnings, you know, for all of us on today's call. So thank you. And of course, a special thank you to Curtis for sharing his expertise with the group today as well. So I'd like to take a minute, if you don't mind, and just share a little bit with all of you about the AIMS Center and the programs that we have available to alumni, as well as, you know, many of others of our constituents. So the AIMS Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation, we are an interdisciplinary center. So what that means is we work with students from all the colleges across the university, and we provide a variety of programs and resources to help those who are interested in either launching a business, so entrepreneurs, or entrepreneurs that want to be innovators within. So we are helping them develop and apply an entrepreneurial mindset. And so I've listed down here the various groups that we work with. And I again want to point out that we offer many programs that are available to alumni as well. And so here's a list of a lot of the programs, and I've highlighted those that are particularly available to alumni. So starting with some of our training programs, we offer very rigorous National Science Foundation Innovation Corps programs that are largely available to individuals affiliated with a university. But going down the list, we have workshops that range from covering topics that are more considered soft skills like leadership, team building, to business framework skills to help you develop your business financials, developing your business pitch, how to write a business plan. Those are all available to alumni to join. We offer speaker series where we bring to the university other entrepreneurs that our community of innovators can learn from. We also offer boot camps, some of which are available to alumni as well. We offer competitions and challenges, which are mostly for our students, but we do have experts and mentors available to alumni. So if you are interested in starting a business and you need expertise in a certain area, reach out to us, because we might be able to connect you with other alum that have expertise in that area. We can also connect you to community members that are entrepreneurs and can be of assistance to you. Our own staff is also available to help, you know, coach you and advise you in your journey as an entrepreneur. So again, feel free to connect with us. We do practice pitch sessions all the time with student entrepreneurs that are getting ready to pitch their business to someone. And so we work with them to help them hone that pitch. We can connect you to various funding sources available through our connections. And our website is a wealth of resources. We have video series that you can take advantage of that showcase other entrepreneurs and how they've learned in their journey and learning from failure and the successes that they've been able to achieve, and many, many more resources available through our website as well. Then lastly, I just want to leave you with a few links to our website, our email address where you can connect with us. And we do have a newsletter that you can also sign up for that will give you access to our schedule of programs. So we hope you'll take advantage of all of those things. Leslie, I just want to mention that we will be sending out the video from today's program to everyone that registered. So look for that. And we also hope that you will take a minute to complete the survey because you know your feedback helps us improve our programs and make sure that they're of value to you. So please do take a minute to do that. And just one more thank you to our panelists, our moderator, to Curtis, and to everyone that attended today. We hope that you enjoyed the program and look forward to seeing you at our next program. So thank you, everyone, and have a great day.